Hello and welcome to C++ Weekly. I'm your host, Jason Turner. In this episode, I'm going to cover something that is actually quite foundational to using and understanding C++, and that is const versus non-const member functions. Now, there's also volatile overload, which I might get into, but probably not. So, if you just want to, learn more about C++, if you are perhaps a beginner to the language, this will be a great episode for you. In the next episode, I'll go into a little bit more detail about how this actually works, though. This episode of C++ Weekly is sponsored by me. Be sure to check out the video description for important links about upcoming events, sponsoring the channel with Patreon, buying copies of my best practices and puzzler books, and how to contact me if you are interested in on-site training or remote code reviews. Okay, so like I said, this is a very fundamental intro to C++ kind of concept. C++ has member functions for our structs and our classes. Now, it is worth noting that the only difference between a struct and a class is the default access level. And I'll probably dig into this a little bit for the sake of this episode, which I don't normally tend to talk about in this YouTube channel, but I default to struct for all of my examples because it just makes the slideware, if you will, a little bit shorter and easier to look at. Now, the very first thing that I want to comment on is that this is a terribly named structure. If you've got a single letter name for your struct, then you should probably give it something better. So let's just pretend like this is going to be called string. So I'm going to make something that kind of looks a little bit like a string, but not at all, because we're not going to implement all of the gory details here. So if you're new to C++, you might do something like this. And we can debate all day about whether or not it makes sense to call this thing m underscore size or whatever. I don't care. That's really not the point of this. But you can't have two different return types on your function now, can you? Okay. Now, this is a function that should be returning a value, and it is not. And we've got our warnings turned up pretty high here. So we're going to get this no return statement and function returning non-void. Very good. So I'm just going to go ahead and make this thing return size. Let's go ahead and create an object of my type string here. And I've just created the string on the stack, and I want to access its value. So let's go ahead and return its current size. And we're going to get a conversion warning here. And you know what? It's kind of actually worth pointing out because if the size of the string is more than the size of a signed 32-bit int, which is, like 2 billion characters, then we wouldn't get the return value that we expect from this. And so that's, it's an argument worth pointing out. So let's not return it and deal with this warning. Instead, let's go ahead and print it. And I'm using the xlint-lib format, of course, here. Okay, string size is 0. And it is printing what I wanted it to. If you are a fan of any of my best practices books or any of the talks that I have given on C++ code smells and the way that I admonish you and encourage you to use const wherever possible, you might be tempted to say, well, this is a const string. And it is. I haven't modified it in this code. But now we're going to see a compile error occur. And it says, I am passing const string as this argument discards the qualifiers. If you're new to C++, this error isn't going to make any sense to you. What it is telling you is that you are calling a non-const member function with a const object. And size should never modify the thing that it's querying. Like it would be extremely strange if we wrote code that did this. If it said, I am going to decrement the size every time you call the size function. So let's go ahead and leave that here and let's go ahead and add const. So now when I add const, I'm going to fix one error and create another error. So you'll notice that the error down here went away, and this is what we wanted because I am calling a const member function on a const object, and that's good. And now this const saves us from ourselves because the compiler is warning us that I am trying to decrement a read-only object. Oh no, you're right, compiler. Why in the world would I try to modify something when the user is simply trying to query the size of the string? So I'm going to go ahead and remove that, and now everything works as expected. And in case you are curious, we can remove the const here and the code still compiles because we can call a const member function on a non-const object. This has always been allowed, and I will demonstrate that. It's doing this effectively. That's allowed with no problem. We're going to get errors from the compiler here saying that we've created objects, variables, that is, that we're not using. It's this unused value, unused variable error here from the compiler. So let's just go ahead and say that's intentional compiler. In this case, I am not planning to use that so that we can illustrate the point. So I have no problem creating a const reference to a non-const object or a non-const reference to a non-const object. Now, if I go back to making this const, I will get an error on line 16 because I cannot have a non-const reference to a const object. Comment that out for now. So I think at this point you can see how const is useful. It signals to you and to the compiler and to the future user of your code that this member function is not going to modify the object that it is being called on. And that's good. We want to know this. It has other implications, very, very rarely performance implications. That's really not the point at all here. This is the point about communicating the intent of the code. If, by the way, before we move on, I convert this to a class, I am now going to get a different compile time error because this is now private. So let's just go ahead and make this a little bit more like what a real string object might look like. There, I am clearly specifying the things that I want to have public access and the things that I want to have private access. Let's look at iterator. And for the sake of illustrating this, I am going to turn off code execution so that we don't have to actually implement every detail. And this is not actually too far off from how a standard string is actually going to work. It's going to effectively return a pointer to the beginning of the internal data storage when you call begin. And similarly, we're going to have an end function. And by simply having these two things, it's actually possible to do a ranged for loop. But this code is not going to compile for a couple of reasons. The main problem is we have not given const access here. We've only given non-const access. So I can change these to const. So this compiles. But now we can only access it in a const way. So if I'm going to go ahead and do this, and let's say I want to get a reference to it, this code's still going to compile because this is going to be deduced as a const reference. But as soon as I want to modify it, let's just say I want to set everything in the string to the character A. Now I did not get a compile time error. The reason I did not get a compile time error, the astute of you may have observed, is that I did not correctly specify the return type of my const iterator begin end. They need to return a const pointer back. Okay, so now we have assignment of a read-only reference character. We need some way of being able to do both of these things. If I take const away here, I'm still going to get a compile error. So the solution is the fact that const and non-const member functions can act as overloads. So if I call a member function on a non-const object, I'm going to get these versions. If I call it on a const object, I'm going to get these versions. And you'll see this throughout the standard library in string and vector, any of our containers, they have const and non-const overloads for all the common accessors that we would need, where we need to be able to get either a const reference or a const pointer back to a thing, or a mutable pointer or a mutable reference back to the thing. Now, I'm sure will be pointed out to me if I do not point this out right now. There is the deducing this from a C++ 23 that simplifies some of the implementation details here. But I wanted to be able to show you the difference between a const and a non-const member function. Let's just do one quick illustration of this actually executing. Okay, so I am calling print string on a non-const object, and I am getting the string non-const printed. If I mark this const, then I should get the string const printed here. And I do. Const is printed. So there you go. I believe that I have covered in a nutshell the difference between const and non-const member functions and their utility, why you might need to implement both of them, and I covered a little bit just about access levels between public and private in struct and class definitions in C++. And everything that I have covered in this example goes all the way back to C++ 98. So there's no fundamentally changed concepts here in any recent versions of C++. In the next episode that I'm getting ready to record, I will cover how the compiler actually implements these things. Like, what does it actually mean that a member function is const or non-const? And we saw just a little hint of that in one of the error messages that we got.